All the way back in 2007, I remember reading a few different articles that had uncovered a rumour the Riddler would appear in The Dark Knight. This meant the movie was rumoured to feature four villains: the Joker, Scarecrow, Two-Face, and now the Riddler. At that point in time, I remember being worried about The Dark Knight. A year later, the movie came out, and the rest is history. So why is it that The Dark Knight can feature four comic book villains, yet still feel focused and turn out great, whilst Black Panther can't really juggle two villains nearly as well? Now, just so we don't incur a whole lot of hate for saying that this movie has a villain problem, when Michael B. Jordan's Eric Killmonger has been touted as one of the best, if not the best, villain in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, let's get some things straight. This movie is important, in much the same way Wonder Woman was important in 2017. And yes, I do believe that fact alone is sometimes reason enough to go out and buy a ticket. If you support huge, game-changing blockbusters like these, that feature lead characters played by people other than whichever designated beefy Chris is available, we will get more of them. But I also think that this means these movies end up being a little bulletproof to any kind of criticism, which is a little disappointing. I get that, as a pasty British white boy, it can come across a little party pooping to shit on a movie like this, but I think if anything, I wouldn't commit the time to writing, recording and editing this if I wasn't a massive fan of the genre, director Ryan Coogler, or stars in question Michael B. Jordan and Andy Serkis. A lot of work went into this movie, and it's mostly very good. I hope that breaking down what worked and might not have worked comes across as a labour of love and an attempt at legitimate criticism, rather than an attempt to belittle the movie. Like, say, creating a dumbass Facebook event to ruin its Rotten Tomatoes score. My legal team have told me to explicitly point out that these people are morons, anyone who agrees with them are morons, and we in no way endorse that kind of tomfoolery.
Done with this sort of thing! Careful now.
Now onto the villains. Before I break down my issue with the movie's handling of its antagonistic forces, let's first break down whether or not Eric Killmonger and Ulysses Klaue are good villains. Back in 2016, lessons from the screenplay explained why Heath Ledger's Joker was such a good villain, and he boiled this down to three factors: the ability to exploit a hero's greatest weakness, the ability to pressure the protagonist into making difficult choices, and competing for the same goal as the protagonist. I would agree that these are good standards to judge a villain by, so do Killmonger and Klaue exhibit these factors? Killmonger and Klaue both test and exploit T'Challa's resolve as a new king. Killmonger reveals the dark truth about T'Challa's father, T'Chaka, a man who he has seen as the perfect king. It is his tenure he hopes to mimic and live up to. Klaue also plays on T'Challa's need to live up to his father, as he hopes to capture the villain and avenge the theft of vibranium that occurred during T'Chaka's reign. Killmonger pressures T'Challa to make difficult choices when the Wakandan Council learn of his family heritage and claim to the throne. His strength as a formidable fighting force is clear, and T'Challa knows that the only way he can hold on to the throne is by facing him in ritual combat. Klaue also pressures T'Challa to make difficult choices under his kingship because of the blood-soaked stamp he's left on Wakandan history. He knows that he must succeed in doing what his father failed to do in capturing or even killing Klaue, to ensure that his council have faith in his ability to lead. Killmonger believes that vibranium is a tool to be donated to oppressed members of society so that they can gain power and turn the tide of racial inequality. This directly conflicts with T'Challa's view that allowing vibranium to proliferate internationally would only result in chaos and death. Klaue also wants vibranium to spread beyond Wakanda's walls, but is a weapons dealer who sees the great financial gain to be garnered from the acquisition and sale of the metal, and he's more than willing to kill people to get it. This is in direct conflict with T'Challa for very much the same reasons as Killmonger, although of course his reasoning isn't nearly as morally complex. On top of that, they're both charismatic, display intelligence and cunning, as well as providing a physical challenge for the hero. Is Killmonger the best MCU villain? He's definitely up there for me. He actually impacts the heroes' lives in a permanent way, just as Loki and Zemo did before him. That's why those villains have been a cut above the rest. Honourable mentions also go out to Ego and the Vulture, who achieved this, but I don't think will stand the test of time in quite the same way. Andy Serkis's Klaue feels kind of like he's jumped in from another, more joke-heavy Marvel movie that we've come to expect, and sometimes that's a little jarring in this movie. Still, overall, he's an absolute joy to watch, and can easily hold his own in every scene he appears in. So at this point you might be thinking, why the hell is this video called Black Panther's Villain Problem? Well, the problem with these villains isn't their charisma, level of threat, or lasting impact, because both of them have all of those things. Both of them. And that is the problem. Both of them inhabit the role of the primary antagonist at different points in the movie, and because of this, the pacing is all over the place. Let's go back to The Dark Knight for a minute. This movie does indeed feature or adapt four comic book villains: the Joker, Dr. Jonathan Crane, the Scarecrow, Harvey Dent, Two-Face, and the Riddler. Well, hey, it's not strictly the Riddler as was rumoured, but the character Coleman Reese is a clear nod to the character. Enigma, mysteries, get it? And aside from the name change, he functions as a textbook Nolanizing of the source material. At face value, that seems like the recipe for an overstuffed Spider-Man 3-a-thon, but when we look at how these characters are utilised, it makes perfect sense. The Joker is undeniably the principal foe, his presence is felt from the very first scene, and he has an involvement with every major plot beat. Obviously, he fits all of the requisite villainous requirements. He's an A-lister. Both Reese and Dr. Crane are the B-listers, as they only show up to illustrate two different plot beats. Once their role in the narrative is done, they aren't seen or heard from again, and have no further impact on Batman's world. But that doesn't mean their function in the movie isn't important or unnecessary. Harvey Dent is the other A-list villain, because he has a hugely important role across the entire movie. Like Killmonger or Claw, his status as an antagonist isn't actualized for the entire runtime, but the difference between Panther's villains and Dent is that the journey he goes through is present for the movie's entirety. He starts off as a heroic figure, actively working with Batman to take on the Joker, but as the movie goes on we are shown shades to his darker side, before becoming an out-and-out antagonistic force in the third act. Dent's arc forms the backbone of the movie, and the Joker's plan ties directly into this. The first villain's plan involves proving that anyone can be corruptible, and he does this by creating the second villain. Their combined presence doesn't ever feel overstuffed, because their roles work in perfect unison.
I took Gotham's White Knight, and I brought him down to our level. It wasn't hard. See, madness, as you know, is like gravity. All it takes is a little push.
If we look at Killmonger and Claw, the same cannot be said. In the first half of this movie, the antagonist is Claw. He's the driving force for the plot. T'Challa and the heroes seek to find and apprehend him, not least because of his stolen vibranium, but because he is keen to make his first success as king the task his father could never accomplish. Because his father died just days before the movie takes place, and this adventure deals with the fallout of that, it places Claw in a good position to be the primary antagonist. The way in which the movie sets up the excursion to Busan feels like it could be the impetus for the rest of the movie, and Claw is front and center to that conflict. During the entire chase sequence in Busan, Killmonger is never mentioned or seen. His presence is never felt, and we have no idea what he's doing in the interim since we were briefly introduced to him. The first time T'Challa and Claw come face to face, it's a cool moment, punctuated by the decades-long anger towards the villain following the deaths of many Wakandans in his wake. T'Challa wants to kill him, but can't. There's a palpable relationship between them brewing, in much the same way great MCU hero-villain relationships have formed in the past. Claw is apprehended, and he goes on to give Martin Freeman's Everett Ross cause to believe Wakanda is not all that it seems. This is of course a big deal, so up until this scene, it's safe to say Claw has done a lot more than Killmonger. In fact, all we've seen so far from Killmonger is the robbery at the British Museum, and it's not clear at that point what his ultimate goals are. Yes, we do see a flashback at the very start of the movie, involving a younger Killmonger and his father, but that isn't contextualised until far later in the story. Across the first hour or so into the movie, the focus is spread too thin between these threads, and the more pressing issue of Claw. When Killmonger does show up in Busan, he breaks Claw out of custody, and T'Challa comes to a startling realisation when he sees the same ring he bears around the assailant's chest. A few scenes later, we learn that Killmonger is in fact Wakandan. And as if this highly important information wasn't the most obvious shift in focus from one villain to the other, the film makes it abundantly clear when he shoots Claw stone dead. Now Claw is out of the picture entirely, the film really kicks into gear and becomes much more focused and interesting. What follows across the second half of the movie sees Killmonger reveal his origins to the Wakandan Council, causing total uproar, he banes the shit out of T'Challa, takes his perhaps rightful place as king, and reunites with his father in the astral plane. It's all handled exceptionally well. Killmonger is legitimately intimidating, and he commands the screen whenever he is within the frame. Like Claw in the first half, Killmonger pushes T'Challa from one narrative beat to the next. And now it's Claw who, like Killmonger in the first half, has a minimal presence. Because he's dead, obviously. When you place these two halves of the movie side by side, it begs the question, why were both characters in the movie in the first place? Now, this is pure speculation on my part, but I do wonder if Ryan Coogler and the team behind Black Panther had an obligation to include Klaue after he was set up so much in Age of Ultron. Not all of the forward thinking in the MCU has panned out, and Klaue's early role all the way back in 2015 seems to be one of those examples. Would it not have been better to save him for the sequel? Killmonger is undoubtedly the right villain for T'Challa's first outing. The only problem is that we should have gotten even more of him. Would it be such a stretch to find a way to repurpose that sequence in Busan to include Killmonger in some way, or to truncate the importance of Klaue's role in the movie so that the narrative can find another good reason for Killmonger to enter Wakanda at the midpoint? I think the movie would be far better served by trimming the fat on Klaue's role in the first half of the movie, and giving more focus on Killmonger from the earlier point. And it's more of a personal preference than anything else, but why was Klaue not saved in some capacity for a sequel? Black Panther doesn't enjoy a vast rogues gallery like, say, Spider-Man, so to axe off two of his best villains in his first movie seems like an incredibly odd decision. I'm just starting to feel sorry for Andy Serkis, really. Getting snoked twice in the last few months, is it any coincidence he's been dispatched by two angsty, ripped powerhouses with a worthy reason to hate the opposing hero? Yeah, it's probably a coincidence. All in all, Killmonger was an interestingly sympathetic and multi-layered enemy, on par with the likes of characters like Magneto. It's a shame he's a one-and-done kind of character, but I think that's probably for the best. After getting to avenge his father, prove himself to the whole of Wakanda, and have a stab at being king, where else is there for him to go? If he'd have stuck around, I'd worry he'd stagnate a little, like the God of Mischief himself. The difference between a good villain and a truly great one lies in the way that they are used. Sometimes less is more. Sometimes knowing when to quit while you're ahead is also good. And sometimes, we need a little bit more to chew on. If you'd like to see more from Full Fat Videos, why not check out our channel, or like our Facebook and Instagram pages for all the latest updates. Until next week, stay